What is going good, people? This is episode 17 of From the Vault. Smash that like button, click that subscribe button, and turn on that notification bell. Thanks to those who have already done so. Now, to keep you guys updated on what's going on with this channel, like me on Facebook and follow me on Twitter. Links to those are in the description box and comment sections below. Also, the poll for episode 22 is up. Prior to that, you'll have episode 18, The Lex Express, episode 19, The First WCW Disney Tapings, episode 20, The Reign of Terror, episode 21, The Black Scorpion. So what's up for the poll for episode 22? You have four choices. First, Vader in 1993. Second, The Outsiders, 1996 through 1998. Third, Diesel from 1993 through 1996. And fourth, The Hollywood Blondes. So Vader 93, Outsiders 96 through 98, Diesel 93 through 96, and The Hollywood Blondes. Vote for the one you want to be episode 22 in the Twitter poll that I have. Link is in the description box and comment sections below. And also, who do you want to win, and who do you think is gonna win? Share those thoughts in the comment section below. But without further ado, this is From the Vault, WCW in the summer of 1998. Now, the summer of 1998 for professional wrestling, it is when it was at its hottest. I mean, you couldn't go anywhere without seeing anything professional wrestling. I mean, WWF, WCW, even ECW. I mean, you look at the WWF, as stated in my previous episode. If you haven't seen it, check it out in the archives. But the WWF in the summer of 1998 was white hot. ECW was probably as hot as it ever was as a promotion. And then you have WCW, who was just as hot. I mean, they were hot in the summer of 96, 97, and 96, 97 in general. Summer of 98, they were still hot as well. But there's this false narrative going around that WCW in 1998 and the summer of 98 in general was when WCW started going downhill. 96 and 97, they were the glory years. 1998 was the beginning of the end, but in actuality, that's a bunch of false narrative bullshit people have spread to write a book and make money off of people. When the truth of the matter is that WCW in 1998, especially in the summer of 1998, had the best business it ever had, and, you know, the summer of 98 was the hottest WCW ever was as a business. Let's just compare the numbers, shall we? Looking at the summer of 1996, the summer of 1997, and the summer of 1998. First, we're going to be talking about June of 96, 97, and 98, and I'm going to be talking attendance, live gate, and Nitro, the averages, shall we? Now, first, June of 1996, the average attendance was 4,000 per show. June of 1997 was 6,600 per show. June of 1998, 8,500 per show, with live gates in June of 1996, 55,000 per show, June of 1997, 104,000 per show, June of 1998, 180,000 per show, with Nitro ratings of, in June of 96, low to mid threes, June of 1997, mid threes, June of 1998, low fours. Now on to July. July 1996, average attendance 3,200. July 1997, 5,300. July 1998, 10,000. With live gates of, in July 1996, 39,000 per show. July 1997, 85,000 per show. July 1998, 218,000 per show at the live gate. The Nitro rating in July 1996, mid-threes. July 1997, mid-threes. July 1998, mid-to-high fours. We move on to August. August 1996, average attendance was 2,400 per show. August of 1997, 5,200 per show. August 1998, 7,800 per show. With live gates, August 1996, 29,000. August 1997, 88,000. August 1998, 172,000. With Nitro ratings of August 1996, low to mid threes with low fours on unopposed nights. August 1997, high threes, low fours with five on an unopposed night. And August of 1998, high fours, low fives with a six on an unopposed night. Let's talk pay-per-view buys. In the summer of 1996, they couldn't hit 200,000 buys for any one of the three shows. Summer of 1997, you had one over 200,000, but and two near 200,000. But then we get to the summer of 1998. The best pay-per-view buy for each respective pay-per-view in its history, with Bash at the Beach being the second highest buy in WCW history. You look at attendance, you look at live gates, you look at Nitro ratings, you look at pay-per-view buys. Hell, I didn't even mention merchandise, and merchandise in the summer of 98 for WCW, I mean, shit, I'll talk about certain things in a little bit, but look at the numbers. Summer of 1998 beats summer of 96 and 97. Numbers beat false narrative 100 out of 100 times. Now, I will say, the problems WCW was having, you know, there were some, but it had nothing to do with business. It had nothing to do with on screen. It had a lot to do it was happening within the people who ran the ship. And no, I'm not talking about the boys in the locker room. I'm talking about the suits within Turner Broadcasting. People who didn't give one iota of a fuck about wrestling, who hated wrestling, but now because it's a successful business, it's doing high numbers, it's doing the best numbers it ever has. Yeah, the people within Turner Broadcasting now wanted to tell Eric Bischoff how to run the company that Bischoff turned from a company on the brink of death in 1993 to a company that nearly put Vince McMahon out of business. You can hear about that can of worms in any Bischoff interview out there, and he goes into great length about it. Now, those were the only problems within WCW. That, I will say, there were problems, but the whole, oh, WCW's going downhill, it's not as good as it once was, all that stuff, again, attendance, live gate, Nitro ratings, pay-per-view buys, merchandise, that summer of 98 beats summer of 96 and 97 by a considerable mark. Now, enough talk about the inner workings, the business side of things. Let's talk about what happened on screen in the summer of 1998 in World Championship Wrestling. And yeah, you had a lot of major things that brought a lot of eyes to WCW. And you had that with the success of 96 and 97. But this was huge. Summer of 98 in WCW, you had a lot of eyes to WCW. And you know, a lot of it was mainstream eyes, and really one of the biggest things, probably the biggest thing for WCW in the summer of 1998, was the mainstream stuff with Hollywood Hulk Hogan and Diamond Dallas Page. You had Hogan and Dallas really having two huge main events for WCW that summer, and you know, people are gonna say, oh, the matches were bad, and you know, the bell always does have to ring, but let's be real here. Who really gives a fuck about match quality when business-wise, mainstream-wise, it was huge for WCW? I mean, first, getting involved with the NBA Finals, bringing back Dennis Rodman, bringing in Karl Malone. I mean, they were a part of the NBA Finals that year, with the Bulls and Jazz, respectively. They got into a bit of a scuffle during the finals, which resulted in Bob Costas making a huge condescending remark, and,
oh, you know, the following month, these guys are going to be taking part in a fake fight on a pay-per-view, and Wild Malone would do that, and blah, blah, blah.
And, you know, first off, fuck Bob Costas, condescending motherfucker. I wish Vince McMahon would have beat the shit out of him during that HBO interview in 2001. Second off, yes, Bob Costas hates wrestling. Yes, Bob Costas was a condescending douchebag, but you know what? He made mention of what was going on. He indirectly gave advertisement for the pay-per-view. So you might have gotten a few eyeballs, probably a lot of eyeballs, because again, it was the second biggest pay-per-view buy in WCW history, that Bash at the Beach show. So got a few eyeballs who might not have been watching wrestling. But, you know, you hear, oh, wait, Malone and Rodman are going to be fighting on pay-per-view? What's this all about? And there you go. But yeah, Dennis Rodman, who had already been in the ranks of WCW as a part of the NWO. Karl Malone got introduced to Dallas Page, and the rest was history. And then you get this match. But originally, rumor has it, it wasn't supposed to be Diamond Dallas Page with this match. It was supposed to be Randy Savage in the Diamond Dallas Page role. You know, things worked out great with Dallas in the role. I mean, plus, Savage would have had to go another month or two because probably they would have had Savage do the partner up with Leno, maybe, I don't know. But Randy Savage had a torn ACL, so he needed time off, so there was no way he could go another month. He was already going a couple months with a torn ACL. So Savage out, Diamond Dallas Page in, and you got a huge Bash at the Beach main event in. I brought up Leno. And second, you know, they got involved with the NBA Finals. They got involved with Jay Leno and The Tonight Show. And, you know, for many years before it became nothing but political jokes and bashing on, you know, just anything politics, late night television was a huge deal. And, you know, for many years, The Tonight Show was king. Thus, who hosted The Tonight Show was the king of late night. And this started the angle of Eric Bischoff. You know, he had his own Tonight Show. He poked jokes at The Tonight Show host Jay Leno, and that started a big back and forth between the two on each guy's show. Eric Bischoff's NWO Nightcap and Leno's Tonight Show. And it was huge. WCW on The Tonight Show? It's like, wait, what's this stuff? Brought eyes to WCW. And eventually, after a few, you know, Leno making Hogan old jokes, you had Hogan and Bischoff invading and taking over The Tonight Show. And eventually, Diamond Dallas Page saved the day. The match was made for Road Wild. Diamond Dallas Page and Jay Leno versus Hollywood Hulk Hogan and Eric Bischoff. And again, say what you will about each of the two main events in terms of match quality and all that stuff. Again, the bell does eventually have to ring. Each main event drew the biggest pay-per-view buy for each respective pay-per-view in its history. And again, Bash at the Beach that year. Bash at the Beach 1998. It was the second biggest buy WCW ever saw. Number one was the Sting Hogan Starrcade. So, put that into perspective. Ultimately, the bell does have to ring. The matches, match quality-wise, were not that good. The Bash at the Beach match was better than the Road Wild match. But again, what mattered most was the exposure for World Championship Wrestling. People who might have not been wrestling fans and might not have been, like, into this. They see, oh, wait. Rodman and Malone are fighting on pay-per-view? What the heck's this? Wait a minute. The Tonight Show? What's all this stuff? People who might not have been fans saw this and this is going to be what the main event is, and people would have bought the event for the main event, and maybe they saw something else they liked, became a fan of it. So all in all, it's like, yeah, the matches, match quality wise, were not as good, but for exposure for WCW, these two main events were a big fucking deal. Now, another big fucking deal about WCW in the summer of 1998 was the meteoric rise of Bill Goldberg. Goldberg debuted in September 1997 on Monday Nitro, and from there, they started an undefeated streak with him. He beat a bunch of lower card, lower mid card, you know, jabronis, basically. He was doing this in no time whatsoever. And then you get to April 20th Nitro, he beats Raven for the US title, and this, I look at this, this was the moment his stock rose. I mean, just watch that match when he gave Raven the first spear. Holy shit. And then after that, Goldberg started beating bigger names week after week. He started beating NWO guys. Eventually, we got the announcement on Thunder just a few days before the Georgia Dome Nitro. Hollywood Hogan would defend the world title against Goldberg. Now, according to rumors, initially this was just going to be a non-televised, non-title match for the Dome crowd where Goldberg would beat Hogan, but Goldberg was so white fucking hot, they didn't have a choice but to go with him. July 6th Nitro, Georgia Dome, Atlanta, Georgia. First, Goldberg had to defend his United States Championship against Scott Hall. If he retained, he would get Hogan for the world title. He beats Hall first. He beats Hogan second. He wins the world title. And at 100 or so matches, zero losses, roughly 10 months in the business, Bill Goldberg was the WCW World Heavyweight Champion. And you didn't have a bunch of whiny fans saying, oh, he didn't deserve it, or it's too early, or any of that other bullshit like that. All you heard was chants of Goldberg, Goldberg. Now, you know, we do hear the criticism about them not doing this at a pay-per-view. You know, Bash at the Beach was that Sunday. You know, why didn't they just save it for a pay-per-view? Why didn't they give it more time and all that? And you know what? Fair points. Here's a few things. Number one, you already had a main event for that show. Number two, more people saw it on free TV versus how many people would have seen it on pay-per-view. I mean, you look at what it did for free TV. It did, you know, it was in 5 million homes. It did a bunch of views. You know, you look at pay-per-view, it was, you know, less than 600,000. So it's one of those things, you know, would you rather have 5 million people see it, or would you have, you know, less than 600,000? I would go with what it being on free TV. And Goldberg, he would go on the rest of the summer defeating Kurt Hennig in his first title defense in Sturgis at Road Wild. He beat both NWOs in the Road Wild Battle Royal, last eliminating the Giant after a spear and jackhammer. And considering the fact Show was about 530 pounds at this point, that was a hell of a feat of strength by Goldberg, lifting and giving Giant the jackhammer. Now, talking about the two NWOs, I have to talk about the civil war between Wolfpack and Hollywood, and this all started in early 1998, though there were teases of one in the spring of 1997. Watch Kevin Nash's promo, the Nitro before Spring Stampede, watch the last couple matches of Stampede 97. You know, there were some teases of dissension within the NWO going back to spring of 97, but you had real dissension starting at the start of 1998 when Hollywood Hogan and Randy Savage relaunched their age-old rivalry, Randy Savage wanted control of the New World Order and felt that holding the World Heavyweight Championship, he would have control of the NWO and Hogan would be at the bottom of the pecking order. And at Spring Stampede 1998, thanks to Kevin Nash, Randy Savage defeated Sting to win the WCW World Heavyweight Championship, and then Hogan would win the title off of Savage the night after, thanks to Bret Hart helping Hogan, turning heel, joining the NWO, and all that was stupid, but regardless, at this point, there was a line in the sand. You had Hogan and his crew, and then you had Kevin Nash and his crew. It was originally Hogan Savage, but Nash really gained control of the new Wolfpack, the red and the black. And then you had Hogan having NWO Black and White Hollywood, Wolfpack Red and Black. And I would be doing a disservice if I didn't mention how white-hot Wolfpack merchandise was in the summer of 1998. It was one of the hottest things in the business and the hottest thing in WCW. I mean, you would get nights where Wolfpack shirts were drawing nearly $100,000 by themselves, which in 2018 numbers would be roughly $175,000, give or take, on Wolfpack shirts alone. The night in the Palace of Auburn Hills, which is Kevin Nash country, you had 16,000 fans in attendance, and they sold out of all 5,000 Wolfpack shirts they had. So to say Wolfpack merch was hot would be an understatement, because again, it was the hottest item in WCW, arguably the hottest item in all of wrestling. The only thing close or beating Wolfpack merch would be Austin merch, so great company to be in. Each sides were taking members of the NWO as well as people from WCW. The Giant, he was one of the mainstays of WCW. He went to NWO Hollywood. Lex Luger, he was the mainstay of WCW. He went to NWO Wolfpack. And then you had the franchise himself, Sting. And for a few weeks, they did a which side will he choose angle. Will Sting join Giant in NWO Hollywood so they can go on as the World Tag Team Champions? Will Sting join Luger, his best friend in NWO Wolfpack, or will Sting stay loyal to World Championship Wrestling? The June 1st Nitro, Sting chose the Wolfpack after first teasing Hollywood. He ripped off the shirt, and then there were the colors of the red and black. The feud continued throughout the summer, even having what originally was going to be an 8-man NWO Battle Royal in Sturgis at Road Wild, but became a 9-man Road Wild Battle Royal when Goldberg entered and Goldberg won. Now, in terms of who was on whose side, you know, you had Hogan and Nash being the leaders. You know, that was perfect. It worked. Hogan and Nash being the leaders of the respective groups worked. But the biggest mistake was having Savage a part of the Wolfpack and Scott Hall being a part of Hollywood when it should have been reversed. It should have been Hogan and Savage versus the Outsiders. And I think even Hall and Nash have said before that it should have been the Mega Powers versus the Outsiders and all of this. Now, you had Bret Hart being an associate member of Hollywood, and Bret shouldn't have been on either side. He should have been one of the few guys in WCW fighting for WCW. Now, the Giant as a part of NWO Hollywood, you know, it worked because he was feuding with Kevin Nash, so, you know, kayfabe story-wise, Giant joining Hollywood made sense. It was what it was. Now, Luger and Sting being a part of the Wolfpack, you know, it's a case of why not? I mean, if they weren't in the Wolfpack, they would have ended up being allies of the Wolfpack because the Wolfpack were babyfaces, and of course, babyfaces all have to get along. So, you know, them being a part of it, it worked, but, you know, if they weren't in it, they would have been allies anyway, so it's a case of why the hell not? Now, I talked about the main angles and the main players and all of that, and, you know, people want to say, well, you know, the mid-card, it was sort of kind of wasted around this time, but, you know, if you look back, there was some really good stuff happening in the mid-card. I mean, Chris Jericho as the Cruiserweight Champion, I mean, this was the time frame, 1998 and the summer of 98, when Chris Jericho broke out and became the Jericho we know today. Someone who is great in the ring, but as a character is just as great. And the Cruiserweight stuff, the stuff he was doing with the Cruiserweights, it actually made the Cruiserweights more than just in-ring stuff. He added depth into the division. The conspiracy victim stuff, starting in the spring but carried over into the summer, was amazing. Jericho going to Washington, D.C., trying to go to the Library of Congress looking for the rules of professional wrestling involving WCW championships was funny shit. He eventually got the Cruiserweight Championship vacated, he won the title back, he lost it, got it back due to a loophole, and eventually losing it once and for all at Road Wild, and then essentially moving to heavyweight when he won the television championship shortly after Road Wild. And Jericho had a ton of momentum throughout the summer, heading into the fall, and, well, we know what happened after that, but... And speaking of the television championship, it'd be hard not to talk about the Booker Benoit Best of Seven series. It started in the spring, concluded in the summer, and this was for a shot at the television championship. And it wasn't for the television championship, no. This was for an opportunity against Fit Finlay for the television championship. I mean, you don't really see that in wrestling anymore. Situations where everything matters. And this was a best of seven for a shot at the third tier title. Ultimately, this best of seven and eventual TV title victory launched Booker T into a singles role. I mean, prior to this, you know, he had a couple of reigns as the TV champion, but he was still considered a tag team wrestler by most people. And after this, he became a singles wrestler, a damn good singles wrestler that used to have tag team success, and it eventually launched Booker into what he became years later. And speaking of title wins, gonna talk about all the different title wins throughout the summer of 1998 in WCW. First, Chris Jericho defeated Dean Malenko to win the vacant WCW Cruiserweight Championship at Great American Bash 1998. Also on that show, you had Booker T defeating Fit Finlay to win the WCW World Television Championship, and then you had Sting defeating the Giant to win the vacant WCW World Tag Team Championships. And no, you know, you're not hearing things. There was a singles match, the main event of Great American Bash that year, between Sting and the Giant, a one-on-one match to determine who would be the World Tag Team Champions. They won the belts the month before as a team. Giant chose Hollywood, Sting chose Wolfpack, so the belts were vacated. Whoever won would be the World Tag Team Champions and would choose the partner of their choosing. Sting chose Kevin Nash as his partner to fill the vacancy. Goldberg defeated Hollywood Hulk Hogan to win the WCW World Heavyweight Championship on the July 6th Nitro. Rey Mysterio Jr. defeated Chris Jericho to win the WCW Cruiserweight Championship at Bash at the Beach 1998. However, it was declared null and void the following night, and the reign is not official. Stevie Ray was awarded the WCW World Television Championship from Booker T on July 14th at a house show. Scott Hall and the Giant defeated Sting and Kevin Nash to win the WCW World Tag Team Championships on the July 20th Nitro, and also on that Nitro, Bret Hart defeated Diamond Dallas Page to win the vacant WCW United States Heavyweight Championship. After Goldberg won the world title, he was also the U.S. champion, but by winning the world title, he vacated the U.S. title, so I had to declare a new champion. Juventud Guerrera defeated Chris Jericho to win the WCW Cruiserweight Championship at Road Wild 1998. Chris Jericho defeated Stevie Ray to win the WCW World Television Championship on the August 10th Nitro, and also on that Nitro, Lex Luger defeated Bret Hart to win the WCW United States Heavyweight Championship, and then the next night at the Thunder taping that would air on August 13th, Bret Hart defeated Lex Luger to win back the WCW United States Heavyweight Championship. Now let's get to some of your guys' questions on WCW in the summer of 1998. If you got questions about the Lex Express, which would be Lex Luger's WWF run from July 4th, 1993 to WrestleMania 10, ask them on Twitter, Facebook, or here on YouTube in the comment section below of this video. So if you want to ask them on Twitter, ask them on Twitter. If you want to ask them on Facebook, ask them on Facebook. And if you want to ask them here on YouTube, ask them in the comment section below. Matt asks, who would you have put in NWO Hollywood and NWO Wolfpack? Well, I kind of answered that earlier. I would have had the Mega Powers in Hollywood. I would have had the Outsiders in Wolfpack. And then after that, I mean, Scott Steiner in Hollywood, Conan in Wolfpack, and Bret Hart in neither group. And that's really hard because... I mean, you look at the rosters themselves, it's like the Wolfpack was kind of outnumbered by Hollywood, but trying to even them out wouldn't have really worked. I really don't know. For sure, Mega Powers in Hollywood, Outsiders in Wolfpack, Scott Steiner in Hollywood, Conan in Wolfpack, that's for sure. Arthur asks, what do you think WCW could have done differently to stay in the ratings war with WWE in 1998? Well, you know, that's kind of, that's another false narrative people want to bring up. It's like, oh, WCW was so far behind in the ratings war with WWE when, in actuality, they were pretty close. They were neck and neck with them. In fact, they beat them a few times during the summer of 1998. So... To say, you know, what could they have done differently to stay in the ratings war with them, they kind of were with them in the ratings war, so there you go. Boog asks, hindsight being 2020, do you think Sting should have stayed WCW instead of joining the Wolfpack? Well, and I brought this up as well. You know, if he would have stayed WCW, he probably would have ended up being an ally of the Wolfpack anyway, because the Wolfpack were babyfaces, and, you know, wrestling 101, all babyfaces must get along, so, you know, should he have stayed? Probably. Him joining the Wolfpack didn't hurt him much. And Johnny asks, all, you know, should Scott Hall chose which NWO group to join instead of returning to face Goldberg for WCW US title that quick? So basically what you're asking is, should Scott Hall have chose which group he would have joined? Well, I think he kind of already chose which NWO that he was going to join when he hit Kevin Nash with the title belt at Slamboree. He was clearly not a member of the Wolfpack. He was a member of NWO Hollywood, so he kind of already chose which NWO he was going to join. So, thanks to everyone who asked questions. You know, not many, but it is what it is. So, if you want to ask questions for the Lex Express, send them on Twitter, Facebook, or here on YouTube in the comments section below. Share your thoughts on WCW in the summer of 1998 in the comments section as well. Like, subscribe, notification, like on Facebook, follow on Twitter, vote for episode 22, and until next time, peace.